Welcome, everyone. We've done a tremendous job getting ready for an earthquake here in California, and we've redone our entire yard, landscaping, water usage, drastically cutting our water usage in order to deal with this horrendous drought that is we're in the clutches of. But the real crisis is this world war that's actually raging now, and it's the war for your attention. Super important to not forget this, because the weaponry of this war is bombarding you. You're under siege. You're under this incredible siege. It's a worse siege than the siege of Leningrad or Stalingrad or whatever you want to call those terrible sieges. It's worse. You're under siege by the weaponry that is being employed in this war to capture your attention, to divert your attention. Divert your attention to where they want it to be. And where they want you to be, where you want your attention to be, eventually is leading you into an incredibly enslaved condition. Incredibly enslaved condition. If you can just get the slightest breath of freedom, you realize this world is so silly. It is so infantile and so silly. And everyone here just is pretending like, well, they're soldiers. They're not pretending. They're fighting to their utmost to pull all attention in the universal attention, to pull it all down into this infantile. I mean, the commercials, the way that corporations approach you is to infantize you, okay? And they've been using Big Mother more and more and more and more and more to insist that we're all infants. And who better to do that than Big Mother? Okay, and that mother's voice is being used in just about everything now. Using mother's voice causes you to react in a way that is more infantile. And causing you to be more infantile is causing your attention to become more and more dependent on materiality, material things, on material thinking, and material belief. And you shutter your horizons, get narrowed down until you're just a consumer cow, doing what they tell you to do, easily being manipulated. And this is an entirely inadvisable condition to be in. God created us entirely free. We're spirit, entirely free. And God did not create us to not know what our nature is, our true nature. We were not created to try and change our true nature or to forget our true nature. That was not the purpose of creation. We're trying to forget what we are. We're trying to forget our true nature. We're trying to forget our true functionality, our true condition, our true freedom, our true safety. We're trying to forget all of that by immersing ourselves in this mirage of vulnerability and impermanence and belief in process and time, all of this stuff. And this is not what God wants for us. Now, we're entirely free to do this. We're perfectly free, so we're free to try and forget what we are. But we cannot forget what we are. We cannot. Because God's will is that we remain as God created us. We cannot forget what we are. But we can immerse ourselves in a program of forgetfulness, which is what is taking place in this world in a severe way. They want you to re-enlist in a program of forgetfulness after you've just been in a program of forgetfulness for God knows how many thousands of years, if not more. And they are now saying, hey, you've got to re-enlist. Well, we're saying we're not re-enlisting. We are not re-enlisting. Read my lips. We are not re-enlisting in a program of forgetfulness. We are enlisting in a program of remembrance, period. That's it. We are enlisting in a program of remembrance. And to do so, we are repentant and say, you know what? The reason why I'm struggling is because not because I'm incompetent, not because my true nature is no longer there or never was there, but because I have a severe continuity problem. This is all important. Otherwise, they'll get their hooks into you. Okay, they'll get, because you'll think, hey, wait a minute, why am I so scared to remember what I am? Baby, there isn't anything to remember. Maybe I've been, what I am has been destroyed. Maybe there's nothing to go back to. Maybe this is all a myth. Maybe I'm just crazy, but on and on and on and on. And then you become all shaky. But if you realize that you, the only problem you have is a severe continuity problem. The only problem you have is a severe continuity problem. Then they can't get their hooks into you. Because as you stumble and get the jitters and all this stuff, you say, well, of course, I have a severe continuity problem because I've been trying to forget. I've been immersed in a program of forgetfulness for so long that what I am, I'm scared of remembering. I'm scared of remembering because it's so different than what I, than my forgetfulness, you know, has been telling me. So of course you have a severe, we all have a severe continuity problem. And by owning that problem, their hooks cannot get into you, okay? The hooks are for the re-enlistment, you know. We have all these recruitment officers recruiting us into this, to a program of forgetfulness, saying, hey, you gotta do this. This is all important. This is, you know, this is honoring spirit. You gotta honor yourself, honor humanity, honor everything we've tried to do here. You've gotta keep it going. No, you don't. No, you don't. This world is so incredibly infantile. The program of forgetfulness turns you into an imbecile. You become imbecilic. When I look at the world, to me, it's imbecilic, this world. Absolutely imbecilic. Their attention is so off track to where it could be and where it needs to be. Where it needs to be is remembering what we are and accepting what we are. There's no other option we have, because God's will is that we remain as God created us, which is spirit, which is truth, which is freedom, which is love, which is light, which is will to experience, will to be adventurous, will to play with ideas, completely fearless, completely confident, completely safe, all of that. We have to remember that, and we have to accept it. There are no exceptions whatsoever. So in re-enlisting in another cycle of forgetfulness, is this no good at all? Doesn't do you any good at all. At the end of that cycle, you'll still have the exact same need to remember, accept, and remember and accept what you are as when you started it. Doubling down and re-enlisting does you no good, except it creates a massive amount of delay, makes the continuity problem more severe, and something you're going to regret. At some point you'll run into this incredible regret, like, wow, I've been wasting my time to an extreme extent here. Why did I do that? Why? Because I have a severe continuity problem, and no one told me about it. No one told me. Even if you realize you have a severe continuity problem, you're going to read all the literature in the world, you're going to turn to all these talking heads, you're going to look high and low. Nobody's telling you you have a severe continuity problem, but we're doing it here. And if nobody's telling you this, then you're not going to accept it. You're going to say, oh, maybe I'm just crazy. Maybe I'm just deluded. Maybe there is no true nature. Maybe this body here in the world is my true nature. You're going to waver. You're going to collapse. So, you know, it's super important to hear that you have a continuity problem. You're hearing it here. And then you realize, hey, I'm struggling, not because I'm crazy, but because I have a severe continuity problem. I'm struggling on the path of remembrance and acceptance of my true nature, not because I don't have a true nature, or it's disappeared, or it's been damaged, or it's sick, or, you know, annihilated. Not because of that, but because I have a severe continuity problem. And that's something that can be worked on. And you say, oh, I can work on that. That's something I can work on, actually. That's what we do here. See, we work on the continuity problem. Melt the continuity problem away to the point where you realize all is universal being. There is no world. There is no world. There's nothing. There's nothing where something stops and something being stops and then something else begins. In order to define a world, there has to be some boundaries, right? There's no boundaries to allness. There aren't any boundaries. All is universal being awareness right now. So you cannot say, well, I'm a body, I'm a person. What do you mean? Identity, all is universal being. all is universal being. That is identity. There's one identity. All is universal being, and I am it, and everything is it. I am it. Everything is it. That's all there is. There's no separate identity somewhere, separate identities. All is universal being. And I'm getting very allergic to the world right now. And we should claim I'm allergic to the world. I need treatment because I have a world allergy. I'm allergic to the notion that there is a world. See, the idea that there's a world and that there's people and bodies and separate identities and all, you know, all these things. I'm allergic to that, crazy belief system. It's a crazy, crazy belief system born of our spiritual pride and our attempt to be greater than God, create separately from God, to be separate from what our true nature, to separate from our true nature and say, I'm gonna be something different than what you created me, God, and my will is stronger than yours, so I'm gonna do it. That's called spiritual pride, spiritual ambition. That is why we are suffering in this crazy infantile dream like. And speaking of dreams, I had a dream last night that was so heavy, I cannot explain it. I cannot explain that dream. That dream. But in the dream, I just became an observer of it, actually. It was so intense, I just became an observer. And I observed what was taking place, and I understood it. I understood it. But trying to translate that into just normal conversation, I don't think I'm able to do it. And what I got from observing it was simply let dreams be dreams. Don't try to change dreams. Don't try to change dreams. Don't try to change the activity of spiritual ambition. Don't try to fix it. It's not fixable. It's going to be heavy. It's going to be this mind-freaking type of dynamic. You feel that your mind is just being, and that's how the dream was. It was so heavy on my mind and spirit. And that's what spiritual ambition does. At least in a dream, it produces a very heavy dream. Ominous, foreboding, frightening, threatening. Threatening insanity, threatening to split you, you know, all this stuff. And so in the dream, I just was an observer. I finally flipped over to, instead of feeling like I was engaged in a dream, I said, this is too much for me. Forget it. And then I just began observing the dream. Maybe that's why they say, be the observer, be the observer. Be the observer of this dream, but the observer realizes they're not in it. They're not actually in it. It's like you realize you're watching a movie and become so scary. You decide, whoa, I'm sitting here and observing the movie, but I'm not really in that movie. Not really in the movie. I'm just observing it. This is simply observing the play of the spiritual ambition of wanting to be greater than God. We're simply observing that, but we are not that. You see, when we try to change ourselves, we are not that. There's a dream of changing ourselves, but we are not that. We are unchangeable. So maybe the first step to realize we're unchangeable is to be that observer of the dream and realize, well, I'm not really, what's happening in the dream is not really happening to me. I'm just observing this. It's not happening to me. We cannot change what we are, but the dream certainly seems to show that you are changeable. What it does is it symbolizes your nature as a dream figure, someone in a dream figure, like a cartoon figure in a cartoon. And then it's like an avatar, so you're in a video game or something. You think that avatar stands for what you are, and then this avatar goes through all sorts of adventures in this dream, where the adventures become very, very threatening, and it seems like, you know, you're going to suffer some horrible fate and all this stuff. But you are not that dream symbol in the dream. That's completely made up, completely arbitrary. It just says, here, define yourself this way. And then that's how you experience changing, the change in what you are. See, the only way we can experience a change in what we are is through dreaming. But when the dream gets too intense, which it became last night, I said, whoa, I'm not going to identify with either of these dream figures here. See, I was identifying with the hero of the dream, but the situation got so terrible for the hero of the dream, I said, wait, wow, I'm not going to identify with the hero of the dream or the villain, neither the hero or the villain. So disidentify with the dream, with the hero and the villain, and see and just observe it. That's what I did. Don't try to solve it, just observe it. There's nothing to solve. What is there to solve in a dream? Or is there a solid in a dream of changing what we are when we cannot be changed? Does anything need to be solved? If we can't change what we are, what do we need to solve? What needs to be solved? Fixed. Nothing needs to be fixed. Nothing. All we have to do is set the dream down. Doesn't matter what the content of the dream is. The content of the dream could be having the symbol, the hero, being, you know, crushed and separated and changed and everything. That doesn't matter. It's only a dream of our spiritual ambition. It's only a symbol of our spiritual ambition. Nothing's taking place to our true identity. Nothing's taking place to it. So why can't we just set the dream down and say, I'm not interested in what happens in the pages of a comic book? And when you get older, you put the comic books down, right? And say, I'm not interested in what's happening in the comic books or a cartoon or something. You stop watching the cartoons. You say, I'm not interested anymore. I don't care what happens. But when you're young, you think it's all important. Oh, wait a minute. What happened to this? My hero. And something happened. No, I got to watch the next installment to see what happened to me. You identify with that stuff. And so you think you need to watch to see what find out what happened to you. Because you're identifying with a symbol of what you are. Just a symbol, which is utterly arbitrary. All symbols have actually no meaning whatsoever, no real meaning whatsoever. They're completely arbitrary. It's just something you think, hey, maybe that could be me if I change myself. Maybe I could be like that. Maybe being like that might be interesting. But we're not like that. We're not. So it doesn't matter what happens to any dream symbol. The whole dream, all the dynamics of the dream don't matter. Shift our attention off of the dream. Ultimately, first, be the observer. Second, shift your attention off of the dream to all as universal being. Vision of oneness. So first the observer, then the vision of oneness. It seems to be. Jesus says we need to dream a dream within the dream, is how he puts it. Dream a dream within the dream. So you're not identifying with the fates of the dream characters. You're dreaming your own dream within the dream, so to speak. Be an observer. So the tremendous conflict between these two characters in the dream that I was dreaming, it was just horrible. This massive conflict, heavy, deep conflict. It doesn't mean anything. There is no conflict. What kind of conflict is there in reality? We can't change what we are. We can't change what God created. God did not create conflict, so where's the conflict? There's no conflict to fix. There is no conflict at all. So what are we doing paying attention to conflict? It's utterly meaningless. Totally inconsequential. Has absolutely nothing to do with what we are. Our life, our reality has nothing to do with us. And this seems to be very difficult to sink in to us. We just think that we need to. No, there's no needs. No needs to fix anything. No need to resolve any conflicts in the dream. We don't need. All we need to do is shift our attention off of the dream. Jesus showed us nothing that happens to a dream symbol means anything. So he says, you want to crucify this body? Go ahead. It doesn't mean anything. Just a dream symbol. So they said, okay. And resurrected the dream. Dream symbol says, okay, you see, I told you, you know, it doesn't mean anything. Doesn't touch my spirit. Doesn't touch our spirit at all. The fate of dream symbols does not touch our spirit in the slightest bit. Now, of course, when we shift our attention off of the dream, we still remain, but we remain as universal being. this, what is this body? There is no body. There's only universal being. We are the ones who define this as a body. So what we're saying is a body doesn't mean that it is a body, or doesn't mean that there is such a thing as a body. Who said there's such a thing as a body? Who said there's such a thing as things, even? We've defined and named, and we claim that these are things instead of universal being. So what we're doing is replacing things before universal being. We're saying there are things within universal being. That is not true. There's only universal being. It's very different. What we've been trying to do is saying all our definitions are true. And then say, yeah, and all these definitions, these are all things and bodies, and yet we're dwelling in maybe a universe and all this kind of stuff. That's delusion. But because we're so used to naming what we call form, and we think that there's form, and we think that it has a name, and it's a thing, and we think we dwell in the land of things, a world of things, but this is completely made up through our own definitions, through our own symbolizing, so it can seem that somehow we're in a separate realm from reality. Reality is all is universal being. That means that there's only one body. That's the body of universal being. And everything that appears there is simply like clothing for universal being, the body of universal being. The body of universal being is inherently unmanifest, as it were, unmanifest. Infinite potentiality, and this is just clothing of the universal being as a way of speaking, or just decorations of universal being. But it's not separate. Nothing is separate from universal being. There's nothing separate. So we're dwelling as the body. What we are, all is the body of universal being. Nothing greater, nothing lesser, all is the body of universal being. So this is where our attention needs to be. This is where our attention needs to be. If it's not there, then we spiral down into incredible darkness and self-deception. Keep this one relatively short. Just a quick pep talk here to get our attention, get me refocused, get everyone's. I've been working so hard, I've been so incredibly stressed out, and just trying to regain my spirit here and my intensity. Like, there's so very little of this in the world, it's ridiculous. You know, where is the intensity? Where is the urgency? Makes you think that there is no, that we're not, that all isn't the universal being, doesn't it? This collective delusion of spiritual ambition is really a collective cesspool, is what it is. You know, and everybody's saying, hey, you got to stay here. This is where you belong. This is where you belong. You know, this is where your beliefs belong. You know, it's like this, and it's just, it's nuts. So we'll see if we can't amp up the intensity here. 2 years, we have 2 years now. 2 years, you know, 2 years of needing to get that all is universal being, and to break free of these arbitrary, symbolic, dream-like definitions and valuing of what is. All is universal being. There are not parts to universal being. There are no parts. They're just a solid block of oneness. Completely solid block of oneness. We need to experience this. Vision of oneness. We need to experience this. And we absolutely will. 2 years of intense pushing. We can do it. We can do it. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.